And a very good morning to you, and welcome to the Trigger Charge Pre-Market Rundown for Friday, November 5th, 2021. I'm Andrew Horowitz. I'm the co-founder of Trigger Charts, where we put together these algorithms that are based on a very important feature of the market that a lot of people kind of omit, and that is volume and price. We look at the volume and price levels to understand more about where investors and institutions and hedge funds are placing their bets, where they're kind of drawing the line in the sand and where they want to look at it. We do this based on what is well known by followers of someone named Peter Stottlemyre, which is called a market profile, which basically looks at where we are from a position of volume and price, and that is then drawn on the charts as you see on the right-hand side there. Basically, what we're doing is we're looking at the levels of interest to give us a much greater level of confidence when it comes to investing. So there you have it, information that you need to know. We're going to be talking about a lot of things today, a lot of different names, also asking you about some of the names that you have as well that you want us to take a look at. Before we do that, we have to mention, of course, that investing involves substantial risk, and past performance is not a guarantee of future results or any results, in fact. And of course, you lose money when you invest. This is only for educational purposes only, and as always, use your best judgment when investing. So with that out of the way, we have on the right-hand side of the screen here, well, that is the Qs. That is the monthly view of the QQQ, which is the NASDAQ 100 ETF, the most commonly used instrument to buy into, to invest, to trade when it comes to the NASDAQ. You can see this very clearly, a lot of green on there. And what you want to do, and why monthly is important to every once in a while look at, is to understand the overriding trends when it comes to an instrument. And in there, you can see that, well, we held support many times after a breakout. The yellow line, important to understand right now, because a lot of people ask, when do I get in? Well, monthly is a little bit different than daily, which is a little bit different, of course, than the, let's call it 30-minute chart, 60-minute chart, 15-minute chart. But basically, the yellow, when we look at the chart on the right here, when we kind of look at this area to the right, what we find here is the yellow, right about there, is what we call an alert. That is, hey, it's a screen and your chart screaming at you saying, hey, wake up, George, wake up. There's something happening here that you need to be interested in and looking at. You need to be understanding, George, John, Joe, Ringo, that there is something going on. And if, in fact, the bar closes still in the yellow, the next line on the upside is going to be a green. And when you get that green, that is a confirmed entry, long or short. And as long as it stays green, as long as you stay green, that means the bias is on the long side. Here you went from 305 to 398. We're going to round that off to 100 points on 300. That's 33%. That goes back another number of months. Really never had a significant amount of time that we could say that there was any drawdown in our belief that the bias, now this is not drawdown on dollars, but on the bias that it was on the long side. So you can see very rarely, but on this chart, you would see this big move up. Again, a lot of green, very clean to look at. And then once we got over the all-time highs for a while, even though we saw that big drop down in 2020 on a monthly basis, you know what? It didn't pull you out. Look at that. Kind of fascinating, right? You got in here on 9:30. So back in September of 2019, you got in on a confirmed, right, yellow to green, confirmed bias on the upside to the long side. And then what happened? Well, there was nothing above. There's a lot of black. And we always teach you, look from right to left, looking right to left. There was nothing really blocking this. There was nothing that really stood out and said, you know what, there's a lot of resistance here. Maybe you should be very careful and look at this as a questionable trade to get out if, in fact, we can't break above. Again, this is on a monthly chart, but you could take this chart and the concepts that we're talking here and revert back to any particular date range that you want to, any particular time frame on a chart, whether it's a 5-minute, which I'm not really a big fan of, but some people like. I like a lot more movement, a lot more qualifying entries and exits and volume, like on a 30-minute. That's the minimum that we use, and that's why on the Commander Series, by the way, you see the minimum is 30-minute right here. So everything is based on a 30-minute chart when we look at our multi-time frame radar screen This is the autopilot and gives you really good information about where we are from, in this case, it's a weekly, daily, 240, 60, and 30. You can do anything you want as long as it's a derivation of 30, whether it's 60 or 90, 120, 240, 480, whatever you want, and the daily and the weekly, of course. So when we look at this, and I give you and I show you these charts, and I say, well, you know, I want to look at this while we do this again, any kind of time frame you want is all the same concept. And that's why there is such a easy way to look at this, because as I've told you before, and I'll tell you again, I need it easy for me. When I'm looking at charts all day long, or we're taking some time to do some research on a bunch of names, you know, you don't want to have to really squint and figure out, well, is that, I don't know, is that a Head and Shoulders? Or what's happening with that particular pattern? Is it a flag? Is it a descending triangle? Well, I want to know exactly what I felt confident with, which was volume and price, market profile based calculations, where those entries and exits are. And you can't, you know, if you're new to this, you can't just flippantly just buy and sell. You have to know some of the details behind it. And that's why we do these. You want to understand that you want to look from right to left. You want to understand where the other resistance points are. You want to see where there is the opportunity for a fast zone, which is a vertical move up versus a horizontal consolidation. Here's a consolidation here until you get above or below an area. Those are things you want to consider. So anyway, a little bit of education there. You can go over to triggercharge.com. And you can check out that. If you have downloaded the Commander Series or any of the other indicators from TradeStation, recognize that there are indicator guides right on the TradeStation platform in the Trading App Store. You can go there and just download the guides. Or you can write us if you want, support@triggercharts.com, and we'll be happy to provide you with a user guide if you don't have it. Okay, back to where we are and what we talk about each and every week. Let's go over some of the things that are going on. Well, no surprise, the Fed is dovish. Yes, the Fed has come out and said that they're going to start their tapering process over the next several months throughout this year and next year, and that is going to bring down, at this point, $15 billion worth of their bond buying each and every month. But remember something, if we're starting at $120 billion right now, that still means by next month they're still at 105, then they're at 90. Right? Then there is 75. There's still 3-4 months out in the future buying $75 billion worth of bonds in their attempt to keep interest rates down. So very important. It's a very slow reduction in bond purchases. So the other thing that the Fed did and why markets reacted so favorably was that they hammered home, I mean, really got into the idea that they are going to allow for rate increases sometime way in the future. Not now, no matter what. We saw a very good jobs number today, 4.6% unemployment rate, 550,000 approximate new jobs added. And more importantly, the revisions to the payrolls in the last few months added about 250,000 new jobs. Now, what's interesting about that is that still is not going to fall in line with what the Fed believes is their important level of forward progress on all this. No matter what the inflation number shows and what the unemployment number shows, the Fed is hell-bent on keeping interest rates low, at least until Fed Powell is either put back and reappointed into his position or not. So right now what we're seeing is that these easy money policies are going to be here for a while. Now, one of the things that's also doing is causing other central banks to follow along. You know, the reality is that because we are showing such a dovish side to what we're doing, the fact is that other central banks have no choice. In fact, just yesterday, we saw the Bank of England go against the grain. They were supposed to be raising rates. Everybody had expected it. And now what happened was that they decided to hold pat as they saw another resurgence of their the Delta variant in the country. But the problem is that they really can't move unless we start moving, because it will really muck up the works with currencies and global trends. So until that happens, it's going to be easy money in the system. As I mentioned, the unemployment report, we saw ADP solid this week, Wednesday. Initial claims, we saw a post-pandemic low on that. That was pretty good. And then again, the numbers today. ISM manufacturing services are pointing towards gains, so that's really good. Yes, we saw a slowdown in GDP for the quarter last week. But the fact is that there seems to be an undercurrent of things getting even more back to normal. And with all the money that was created by the wealth impact and wealth effect of the markets, and on top of that, all the things that are going on with regard to the stimulus programs that may or may not get passed, we'll see what happens there, and all of the former programs that were available and have been flowing, there's a lot of money out there. We've talked about this time and time again. There's an incredible amount of liquidity. Factory orders and productivity, though, slowed, which is kind of interesting. You wouldn't expect that if you saw the manufacturing numbers up and services and employment up. So something's a little wonky with some of these numbers, but we would expect that. The idea that we can rely on old metrics in this kind of environment, where we have an economy a year ago that was shut down to an economy to where we are here that is flourishing and that there is reopening happening around the world, you can't use the same metrics. So I think it's really important to understand that when we are looking at the markets right now, understand, one, where's the trend? Number two, why is the trend there? The trend is there because we have so much of this overall pent-up demand that's really been flowing. The second issue is we have a problem with supply chain, but yet we do not have a demand problem. The third thing is there's even more money going to be pushed into the markets through stimulus, through other programs, and everybody is just happy and pappy and jibby and gribby, looking forward to putting more money to work on a regular basis. The more money that people, the more people that come to work, the more money there is for investment. The more money, the more people that are at the workforce, the more people that are involved in the 401k. The more the people are involved in the 401k, the more on a regular basis money is pushed into the market automatically, mechanically, week after week, month after month, year after year. Just remember that. Now, am I totally bullish here? I think markets are severely overdone right now. Let's take a look at the KRI, which gives a little bit of a look-see into this. You'll notice that there is a significant amount of overall clusters that are forming, right? These little red dots on the key reversal indicator, market mildly overheated. We see that over here, up plus four. We saw this big move up to the plus five and then a rotation down. That's what we're looking for now. If we see another plus five, plus six, you know, there probably is going to be a cooling off period. Question is how much? You know, we're going to see this kind of move that we saw here, or just a quick move for a few days, or just even a slight down and right back up. You know, what we're finding right now is, you know, it's no secret here, is that there is a buy the dip mentality that anything that drops for a significant amount of time looks like it's a bargain, and let's buy it up. We see that with stocks all over the place. The other day we saw a stock called Open Door dropped on some news about Zillow's iBuy program really being a problem. Opendoor pretty much does the same thing. Zillow's closing it down. Zillow is going to be taking a 25% reduction in their overall workforce. Stock down horribly from its top. I mean, just miserable. And, Opendoor kind of had the same reaction, not as bad. However, the next day I was like, well, wait a second. Opendoor didn't say anything bad, and maybe it's really okay for them. Stock is up 14%. Just yesterday. So just keep in mind that, you know, what we see is this buy the dip mentality like we've seen with the coins. And you can see on the top right now, where are we? Well, the index for the Dow Jones futures up 126, 20 on the ES after a miserable day yesterday for them. And then, of course, the NASDAQ seems to be keep on running no matter what, even though interest rates go up, which it really is kind of weird that that happens, but it does. Let's take a look at, I want to show you something else here. Yeah. This I thought was really interesting. Also, we're seeing the McClellan topping out here the Spearman. This is Spearman on the right-hand side. This is a really interesting indicator. You want to watch this. We've seen this before, this kind of duck bill that's going on right here. Kind of draw the duck bill right here, right? And you can see that. And we're seeing this flatten out at 96.5. You don't really see that often. It's pretty much peaked out right now. Sometimes you see that on the bottom where it's not moving very much. But yet right now, we're not seeing a real opportunity to sell off. Interesting, the advanced decline line yesterday. I don't know if I have that here. Do I have that here? Yeah, here's the advanced decline line right here. Yesterday's advanced decline line. The decliners, 1,800 to 1,400 advancers. In other words, the decliners, even in up market yesterday for both the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ, not so much the Dow, it was only 30 stocks there. It was slanted, even though the markets were up, once again, towards the decliners. Interesting. Something just put in the back of your thoughts and realize that we've seen that a few times recently, even though the markets were up. The decliners. So that means pretty much that the overall strength of the market has been based on fewer and fewer stocks and is concentrating. So the breadth of the market is not where you want it to be. Follow up on hedging. I mean, we talked about this last week, you know, what, where, what could, is it possible? Maybe. What could you have hedged to actually been beneficial over the last month or two? Not really much. You had to be right on with maybe an individual name, which is not hedging, or a individual sector, which is very difficult. It doesn't really hedge a portfolio. It's just a trade. Again, we have slanted index constituents is one of the reasons right now. Like, for example, Tesla. Tesla is a big part of many indices. And that's a problem because what's happening is Tesla is leading the overall indices into areas. Let's see, take a look really quickly. TSLA up 2.5%. But I mean, this move here from, you know, let's call it beginning of right there. What do we got? So the end of October, 833 to 1240, 40% move. And if there is that much positioning in an index, whether it's a NASDAQ, whether it's a consumer discretionary, that really causes a significant amount of upside opportunity right there. And what you're seeing in that is this crazy move that is based on EVs. You know, we mentioned EVs on anything, everybody gets all giddy. I talked about the KRI and the Spearman, and we talked about the clusters. Back to the cluster discussion here for a minute. We're seeing these clusters that are forming right here. Oftentimes when you see that kind of level, it's very difficult to sustain, and one of a few things is going to happen. One, either you're going to see that there's going to be a cooling off period. Let's look at this, for example, right here. This kind of didn't make any new highs. It kind of just 4, 5, 6 days kind of held in there. Or you see what happens sometimes when you get these is a roll, a quick roll. Now, again, I like to see when we're over the 5 or 6, that's when we start getting a little huffy puffy. Right? You start getting a little bit here and you drop. Again, in this market condition, though, with so much money floating around and slosh in the system, hard to see unless something very significant happens, that like a change in the interest rate environment by the Fed. Coinage, Shiba Inu is rocking and rolling, of course. We saw the Squid Game coin. If you haven't seen that and tracked that, you really need to read the story on this. It went from up, I don't know, 400,000% or some ridiculous, I don't exactly know the number, it was some ridiculous number in a matter of a week or 2 weeks, and then to zero the next day. It was a big scam. They took the money out and they ran. So look at that. One thing I want to teach you and let you know, or at least give you information on, some people have asked me about this and wrote in, they're asking about commodity prices and futures and what to use. And when you're charting on our system, you want to have as much data that you can into putting it into the to our indicators in order to calculate the most and most accurate information. Okay, that being said, when you're looking at various commodities and futures, instead of using the actual expiring contract or the actual spot contract, you want to put an at sign, the amp, or this kind of, you know, A with a this little guy right here, wherever it went here. I want to put that in front of it and use the generic. Now, you can use like something like a CLZ21, for example, and that will give you the generic levels. But if you just use the CLZ21, what's going to happen is you're not going to get all the data that you want in there. So you want to use the generic contract as most as possible. Finally, before we get to the stocks, I'll mention to you, as I do every week, that if you are a new user to the Commander Series, what you want to do is write us at support@triggercharts.com. support@triggercharts.com for a free course that we will provide you the passwords for. It's a three-part coaching session on how to understand the technical matters of markets. So make sure, if you are a new user, to do that. Just write us at support@triggercharts.com. I thought this week we changed it up a little bit, talk about some of the things that went on last week with some of the names that we talked about that looked like they were ready to rock, and then come into what some things are this week, and we'll talk about some of your stocks. We've got a couple of people asking about SQQQ, TEX. Now, first of all, let me tell you a couple of things. With regard to this name, what we do, if you do decide for whatever reason to trade the Qs, and in particular, this is the 3-time leveraged Q short. That's what SQQQ is. Do not use this as a guide. Now, you could if you want. You know, right here was a great level 660, dropped off, and you can trade it, etc. I much prefer you use the base. You use the base and then reverse your trade, right? So if, in fact, we saw that there was on the QQQ a short, like you saw here, right? This kind of moved down here. That would be a signal to get into SQQQ. That would have been right there. Use this as your guide of when to move in and out of the Qs, in particular your situation, the SQQQ. The problem with the SQQQ is that it doesn't have as much volume. It's also a daily mover. In other words, they calculate the daily performance of it rather than what they do with the Qs, a much different philosophy. Z, somebody's asking us about Z. Let's take a look at that. Not a good looking chart. Now, actually, let's back up the daily. It hasn't been a good looking chart since, above 200, right? I mean, it actually dropped in and started consolidating. Look at this range. Perfect, beautiful looking head and shoulders. I mean, you can see this very easily, right? This, and then here, then you'd have to do like kind of, okay, well, what's that? How much is that? That's 200 down to 120, 80. This is down here, 200 down to 120, 80. So you would have to think there's another 80 points from 120 is down to 40. I mean, that would be theoretically your value. Right now trading at 67 after a miserable report and a massive loss. There's nothing I could really tell you except maybe possibly trying to look at this as short-term trades. Hasn't been one right now. Looks like you may be basing out a little bit in this range, but again, there is nothing on a chart except for the word miserable written across this. In addition, when you go out a little bit longer and you look at the trade right here, it's the momentum. This is the aileron, which is an add-on to the Commander series. The aileron is also showing negative momentum, so not so good. Somebody was asking about Ford. Let's take a look at Ford. Looking beautiful. Up another 2% today, breaking out to all-time highs. Ford has been in a nice uptrend for a while here. A couple little spotty moves and consolidations, which you'd expect, then just taking off for a variety of reasons. Plus, the earnings recently were really good. You see the momentum factors really were in your favor in this trade. So that would say to you, you lean on the long side anytime over here versus exactly the opposite, where we had from July through September, which is you lean on the short side anytime. This based out of 12 at 17 or 50%, give or take a couple of dollars. Asking about pins, P-I-N-S, another miserable move on a stock. This is Pinterest. There was this big move up here. Everybody's all excited. There was some rumor that maybe this would be bought by PayPal. We talked about this range way back when. You got below this level and all bets were off. That's what we showed you, right? Said, hey, if you get below this level of 62, there's nothing. Why? Because let's take a look at this. What do we talk about all the time? Looking from right to left. Always looking that way, right? Always looking over. Now, when I did this and I say, okay, well, let's take a look here. There's nothing in this range. Look at this range right here. There's nothing going on here. And once you got below these levels and even the level here, there's nothing below here. When you look at this, what happened was that really there was nothing to stop this from getting just obliterated. So that's kind of what happened there, and that played out pretty well due to some earnings and the reopening trade as well. Last week we talked about DWAC, and I kind of want to throw this out to you and show you what happened here. You know, a couple of times, let's take a look at this, move over. So a couple of really good runs on this stock midday, you know, last week. This big move up to 160 from 40, that was ridiculous. But you kind of take that out of the picture. Let's move this over a little bit. And there were some really good opportunities that kind of presented itself, but then faded out. A few trades, you know, from 58 up to about, where is this here, right here, 65, 7 points. Right now, DWAC does not look like it's in play. BKKT, though, on the other hand, we saw some kind of good runs on there. Right now, trading at 35.05, which is right on its line right now, holding support, getting back above there. This is an interesting chart because on a daily pattern, you see a little bit of a pennant there. You see the opportunity on the momentum here. Interesting NFT-style concept, or at least I wouldn't say NFT, I'll say blockchain-ish style company. PHUN, big moves again, had these great runs throughout last week. This was on the second, this early part of this week. We talked about this last week, from 355 to 5, almost a double right there. probably would have gotten out somewhere about 435. So make a buck on 350, 33% in a consolidation mode right now since then. We talked about Ford. WBX, another major winner, right? This big pop and then drop. Wide range. Look how wide this range is. If you take your box tool, so you could take these various tools on TradeStation. Take this box tool and look how wide that range is on there. You know, 13 to 27. That's 100% up, 50% down. That's the kind of thing you want to stay away from after this incredible flat base. Bottom line, though, on this, on Wallbox, interesting stock, interesting name, is that you see this momentum really picking up dramatically. BITO, I think we talked about that. Upstart last week. Let's see what else we got. Toast. Toast was a really interesting name this week because we kind of moved in an IPO fashion, as you see it, above levels, above. It did for a second move above the all-time high of the IPO and then settled down very significantly. This has been on a nice run, Tan. Let's see, what do we got for this week, though? Moderna getting pummeled yesterday and today. Currently trading at 241 pre-market from 279 overnight. Planet Fitness, you know, the exact opposite of what you saw with regard to Peloton, which is actually, let's just bring up Peloton this morning and see where we are. Peloton's down 32% this morning. It is down, let's see, at what price? 57 below where you can even see it on this chart, way down here. Bottom line on this, they missed earnings and seems that they're having all sorts of execution problems. But when we look at, what stock are we looking at there? PLNT. I was kind of on the short side of this for a while. Then I kind of gave up and said, we're not going to stick with that somewhere over here. Currently trading at what? 95.97 on the Pfizer pill, which we got to talk about now. Pfizer up 9.5%. Still not an all-time high, well below it, interestingly enough. But they have a pill that came out this morning that may help with the combination of that pill and their HIV cocktail, something or other. 89% number of fatalities averted and hospitalizations reduced. And that is really helping a lot of companies, particularly those that are in the reopening. Look at, for example, the airlines, JETS, up 4.8% today. Dropping. Now currently at 24.28, right about there. Still has a long way to go to break out. You need to get above 25 and change. Etsy dropping today, rising today, dropping a little bit today after rising dramatically after the earnings numbers. What was really interesting to see here is that Etsy dropped right into, you can see this, it moved, I think, very appropriately and easily right to its level, right? And then it kind of popped right back up. On this, you want to see when you can hold those levels. It's a really important sign. You also notice that you got a, right about here, you got a confirmed entry on the long side. And on top of that, you saw that all of a sudden, we were moving to the upside from being low here. That what that did was it provided us this really nice channel, and then you came in and then broke above it. A lot of lines going on there. We're going to get rid of those because it looks so kind of messy. BBBY. This is one of the meme stocks really hit fire last week. Some discussion about them being involved with Kroger and being added to Kroger's online ordering process. You could also, I guess, buy a blender when you buy some bananas. So stock ran up. I mean, that was kind of ridiculous, from 15 up to 25. That was pretty amazing. The only one that was more amazing was probably Car. Avis Budget moved from about 175 up to about 525 or so here. 545 was the high. That was some short squeeze right there. Open, I mentioned this yesterday, about yesterday's move. Drop down right with Zillow, right into its line. Look at that. Beautiful. You got a quick false signal here of a short. I would not have shorted that due to the fact there's a lot. See, again, looking from right to left, you know, look what's going on here. You know, you're looking at these levels, right? There's all these levels here, all these levels that seem to be, especially this one right here at 19, that seem to be a very sticky point. It doesn't look like there was a lot of room for this to move. Okay. So there you have it. Everybody, I'd like to thank you for joining me and let you know that we'll be here again next week. Go over and get yourself all the freebies that are out there because we have a lot of free trials, 10-day trials, full use of all the features. There's nothing held back in any of the trials over at the TradeStation Trading App Store. I want to thank you so much for joining me, and I'm going to see you next week. And I wish you the best in making money with all that's going on right now. Thanks so much for joining me.